5 tips and techniques for painting fur in watercolour is our focus today, and we're going to look at this with my painting of a black bear cub. Welcome to my Wildlife in Watercolour YouTube channel. I'm Paul Hopkinson, a professional watercolour artist. I specialise in painting wildlife, and I love sharing my tips and techniques with all of you here on YouTube. Now today, I'm going to talk about 5 really important things to think about when you're painting fur that you want to look realistic. Now if you use these techniques within your own paintings, I hope that you'll see an improvement in the fur that you paint, okay? Now you should be able to see a more realistic looking animal with fur that you feel you can touch. So my first tip would be to think very carefully about the colours that you use for your foundation wash. Now I always like to look deep into that reference photograph to kind of see those fine colours, those really deep colours behind the scenes, so really deep within the fur. Try and imagine yourself parting the fur apart and looking for the colour really at the background, you know? So I do this with my photograph on a tablet or an iPad, anything like that would be fine. And pinch into those fine details and then look at those little colours there within the pixels of the photo. But working in a kind of wet in wet gradual wash, and then we can start to think about the tonal differences. We're looking at the light and the dark areas. And these foundation colours will be the sort of behind the scenes colours that we need, and the shape as well in the background. So when we do add those details over the top, these shapes, because we've put the wet in wet washes in the right place, will help kind of form the three-dimensional feel to the animal. But don't make these washes too dark, so try and keep them fairly pale. And the reason behind that is because you've got to keep thinking about when you add those fine detailed lines over the top, these detailed lines are going to be much darker colour, so much more pigment and much more richer in value as well. So these underlying washes are there to kind of support all those details that we'll be adding over the top. And as with everything that we do within watercolour painting, planning is the key. So think about this beforehand, test those colours out before you start thinking about applying these foundation washes. And then when you know you've got it roughly about right, not just in your mind but also on the paper, then go for the main painting and give it a try. Secondly, the direction of the fur is incredibly important as well, especially if you want that animal to look realistic. Now what I suggest you do with this as well is look back at that reference photograph, and it's something that I always go on about within all my videos, I know. But when you look at that reference photograph, you can look carefully at the direction of the fur, the kind of angles that the fur goes at. So areas such as the ear, where the kind of directions are completely different, the area around the nose. Actually, when you look on the bridge of the nose, between the eyes, when the hair comes down between those eyes, you find that very often those hairs suddenly change direction along the top of the nose, also down the side of the muzzle. So look on these directions, look carefully at that reference photograph, the directions of the brush strokes that you need to apply. We must keep looking backward and forward at that reference photograph. It's something that I always tell people I know, but you need to keep doing that because at least that way, it kind of helps with me anyway, the image stay in your mind that little bit longer. So for me, it's every few seconds backward and forward. Which is why, which I said, I've got it on a tablet in front of me, in front of the painting. So I can just quickly glance backward and forward to ensure that I've got things in the right direction. So the fur is going the right way. And all them first directions will give you the overall shape as well. If you find these techniques helpful and you would like me to share some more tips and techniques for painting fur, can you click on that like button down below? That thumbs up tells me I'm on the right track with my videos as well. It also tells YouTube that the content on my video is really good, and then they share it with even more people. Now don't assume that the first layer of detail that you added is actually in the right direction. So be prepared to kind of reassess your painting as you add further layers and kind of change or amend things as you need to. Now I work on what I call the clock face, okay? And all it simply is that I will very often mention in my videos on my website is the direction the brush strokes need to go in. So if I say to you 10 o'clock till 4 o'clock, so you know the rough direction that on a clock face, okay? Or 3 o'clock to 9 o'clock, it'll give you some ideas in your own mind again on the direction you need to go in with the brush strokes. You know, I was really pleased with this little bear cub when it was finished. Now the complete tutorial, by the way, with full instructions is almost 6 hours long and is available on my online school. Now take a look at the card to the top right if you're interested in finding out more about becoming a member. Now the third technique I would suggest you try to master is really the thickness, or rather the thinness, of your brush strokes. You find when you're painting fur that the lines are really made up of very fine detailed lines, so very fine little marks. So as realistic artists, we are kind of endeavouring to replicate these little fine hairs. So what you've got to really think about when you're doing this is by not overloading that brush. So don't have too much paint on your brush when you go into the painting process to work on things like fur, because obviously you're just overlapping layer upon layer of fine details, obviously in the right direction, which I've already spoken about. So just remember that thing as well. When you're working with these fine layers, think about the thickness and the thinness, of course, of those lines. Now the actual thickness of your lines is really determined by a number of different factors. So think about the type of paint you're using, okay? So if the type of paint is, well, I mean, we're talking about something like the quality of the paint. So if it's really good quality paint, you find you need to use less water. And also, if it's a really rich pigment within that colour, how much of that pigment do you need to use? So think about that when you're working on it. Also the consistency of the paint. So do you need it watery, milky, creamy, or really thick? So think about those four different consistencies of paint, okay? And try these out on test paper first if you're not sure as well, if it's gonna kind of work okay on your painting. Also, another little tip as well is how worn is that brush? Sometimes it's handy to have a very kind of warm brush for certain techniques. But when you're working with fur, having a good fine tip on that brush is vital for me when trying to get those fine detailed lines. Another thing you've got to consider as well is how do you load that paintbrush? So do you just dip it into the paint and just go straight to the painting? Or do what I do, you're going to load it, you're going to roll it, and you're going to tap it. So what you're going to do in that case is by rolling it in the painting you're mixing well, roll it as you pull away from the side of the mixing well, and then tap it once on some kitchen roll, just kind of taking a residual paint off that brush. That way, you'll find you've got a nice fine tip on that brush to start working those details. How much water do you have within your brush as well? If you find there's a lot of water within those hairs of your brush, it all depends on the kind of brush you're using, of course, whether it's sable or synthetic. Certain brushes hold more water than others. So if there's a lot of water within the belly of that brush, or even inside that metal ferrule, because you've got to remember those hairs go inside the ferrule, don't they? And they will still kind of absorb the water within them. The water content within the brush will also affect the consistency of the paint when you apply those detailed lines on the paper. Consider the type of paper you're using as well. Is it hot pressed? Is it cold pressed? Is it really smooth? Is it really rough? These all make a difference between kind of trying to get those very fine detailed lines or having a rough, kind of bumpy, broken line as you start to apply it to the paper. Consider the amount of pressure when you apply that brush to the paper. So using the very finest and lightest of touches should give you the finest of marks. However, the more weight that you apply to that brush, the more heavy-handed that you are with the brush, the thicker the lines will be, obviously. So these are things you've got to consider again when you're trying to get those really fine, thin lines to be able to paint very detailed looking fur. Now, one thing that you might be interested in as well is I've got a whole video focused on painting fine lines. So I'll pop a little card to the top right hand corner of the screen for you so you can have a look at that one later on. The fourth thing to consider, which I've already sort of started, is a need to work on layers of the fur. See, fur isn't just a single layer of hairs. It isn't, obviously, it's multiple layers of hairs that lay on top of one another and kind of feel soft to the touch as well. And that's where we want to kind of create that feeling of like a soft feel to the fur. So we have to replicate that with our brush, and working layers of paint is a really good way of doing that. I always start with the lightest colour first, which is quite normal within watercolour, isn't it? You go light, then you gradually get darker with every layer of details that you apply. So, as I say, the lightest colour first of all these details, and just make sure that you cover the entire animal with this palest, lightest detailed layer. Starting light and gradually working darker will actually enable you as well to kind of fine tune those details and make alterations, and also correct mistakes that you may get along the way. By going too dark too quick, you find it's harder to kind of fix a little mistake, which is very tricky to do trying to lift off dark paint. So always start lighter when you're working on kind of any hairy animal, and think about those layers of detail. Now, every layer that you apply, allowing each layer to dry by the way in between, will gradually get darker naturally anyway, even if you're using the same mix of paint and the same consistency. Because don't forget, watercolour, you can layer the details all over the top of one another, and every single layer that you apply will naturally get darker. However, you can thicken that paint down as well, and by doing so just add more pigmentation within those colour mixes you've already got. Then considering the overall contrast within the painting, so look for those darkest areas. And when you add those in, that's when it gets really dark and the overall kind of three-dimensional shape of the animal you're painting will start to come together. Now at the moment I'm releasing a brand new video here on YouTube every single Friday, so hit that subscribe button down below if you've not already done so. If you also click the bell icon, you should be notified when new content has been published. And it's also a way of letting YouTube know that my videos are certainly worth watching. My final tip for today is related to the length of the lines that you paint. I know I mentioned about the lines and the thickness earlier on, but just bear in mind that fur is never the same length all over the animal. For example, the length of each individual hair will vary considerably, even within a small area, okay? So look around, as I mentioned, the nose, around the eyes. Very often the neck or around the ears can be tend to be a little bit longer in fur, depending on obviously the animal that you're painting, of course. But you'll also find, say on the bridge of the nose, just as it gets towards the tip of the nose, it gets very fine, very tiny, tiny stipple marks. We must also look closely again at that reference photograph. How many times have I mentioned the reference photograph today? I know, but it's very important, okay? And note where the longer hairs are, where they're shorter, and where they change in between the two kind of lengths. So make little notes on that. Even if you got to kind of put a little reference marks on your painting, just little fine marks so you know roughly about the length of those lines, and obviously the thickness as well. Another tip as well when you're working with fine hairs is practice that first of all. So grab a little piece of scrap watercolour paper, preferably the same make and type that you're doing your main painting on. Then use that scrap watercolour paper to test on the kind of feeling that you're going to get when you're working with those fine lines. How much pressure to apply when you're using the brush. How much paint you actually apply to the brush when you load that brush up. Is there too much paint there, or is there not enough and you end up getting like a dry brush effect? So all these things need to be considered, as I mentioned, including the consistency of the paint to help it flow. If the paint's too thick, it won't flow. So thinking about painting a line in one kind of flowish movement, and if you can't do that on your watercolour surface, invariably the paint is too thick. If the paint dries too pale, then you know it's too thin. So that's why testing these ideas out first on some scrap watercolour paper is quite vital really if you're not entirely sure if it's going to work or not. So for example, when you look at this bear cub and you're looking around the paws, look how fine those lines are around the paws, how thin they are, how long they are as well. So you've got to bear these kind of things in mind. So remember, it's not just the length of the lines, it's the thickness of the lines, it's the consistency of the paint, the quality of the brush that you're using as well, make sure you've got that fine tip on the tip of the brush. The overall brush direction as well, again, look at the reference photograph. I'm not going to say it anymore, am I? No, I won't. And all these things you've got to think about when you're doing these paintings, okay? And put them little reference marks down on the painting before you even start working on those details. Just kind of give you a bit of a guide, sort of mapping out the painting before you even start on those little details. Which of these five tips and techniques will you be using in your furry animal paintings from now on? Let me know in the comments down below. Are there any techniques that you use that I've not mentioned yet? So please let me know. Now, whilst you're thinking about that, I'll see you in the next video to my right, which is all about painting black fur. Now that's another level altogether. So I'll see you there, and let's get them brushes wet.